Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the invitation. During this presentation, I'm going to talk about the evidence for the use of adrenaline and amiodarone during CPR. This is my conflict of interest. I'm a member of ILCOR and the ERC BLS task force. So this is the advanced life support algorithm as we know today. And if we look to the use of drugs, we can see here on the bottom that adrenaline can be given every 3 to 5 minutes and amiodarone after the third shock. So, but what is the evidence for the use of these drugs? Indeed, we've been using adrenaline since the first CPR guidelines in 1964. These were the guidelines drawn by Peter Safran. And you can see here that already adrenaline at the same dose was already reported. And again, in the first ALS algorithm from 1997, there was here give adrenaline, epinephrine actually, every 3 minutes. So basically we have been using adrenaline for many decades for cardiac arrest, and it has been considered as the standard of care. However, the evidence was based only on limited observational studies, and there were many uncertainties about benefits or harms, especially on long-term survival. Indeed, this is an experimental study showing the so-called paradox effect of adrenaline, showing an increase of the myocardial oxygen consumption. Or this is another study focused on cerebral microcirculation, showing that adrenaline reduced the cerebral microcirculation and oxygen level in the brain transiently after its administration. This is one of the main studies showing the effect of adrenaline. This is a randomized clinical trial performed in Norway in 2009, where 850 patients were randomized to IV drug or no IV drugs. And the main drug, of course, was epinephrine. As you can see, patients receiving drugs achieved a significantly higher rate of ROSC, 40% versus 25% in the placebo group. But then if we look at the long-term survival, intended as hospital discharge or 1 year survival, we can see there is no more evidence of any benefits. So we can get more ROSC with adrenaline, but then more patients die during the hospital stay. This is another randomized clinical trial where 4,000 patients were screened and 600 were randomized to placebo or adrenaline. And again, you can see that adrenaline increased significantly the ROSC, but no effect on long-term survival and neurological outcome. This was true also for shockable rhythms. Only for the non-shockable rhythm, there was limited evidence of benefit for long-term survival, although only 2 patients in the adrenaline group survived compared to 0. So the number of patients was very small. This is one of the most famous registry study in Japan, more than 400,000 patients. You can see that there is a favor in the use of epinephrine related to short-term outcome, ROSC. But then when we look to the long-term outcome, so 1 month survival or neurological outcome as a CPC 1 or 2, there was no any benefit in the use of epinephrine. But however, so all the evidence that we had till a couple of years ago was a clear effect on ROSC and the short-term survival, but no data on long-term survival. Then in 2018, this study was published, the Paramedic 2 trial, which was a pragmatic randomized placebo-controlled trial. The primary endpoint was 30-day survival, and the second endpoint was neurological outcome. And in this study, 8,000 out-of-hospital cardiac arrest patients were randomized to epinephrine or saline. Below, you can see the baseline characteristics of the population, and they were very similar between the two groups, also for the cause of cardiac arrest and the CPR performed by bystander, which was 60% in both groups. And then this is an interesting data. You can see that the interval between the emergency call and the administration of adrenaline was 21 minutes in both groups. When we look to the average dose of adrenaline, they were approximately 5 doses. And here are the results. Again, this trial showed a clear effect of adrenaline on ROSC with a triple rate of ROSC compared to placebo. When we look to the 30-day survival, it was 3.2% in the epinephrine compared to 2.4 in the placebo, and this was significant with the nodes of 1.5 almost. But when we look to the neurological outcome, there was no difference between the two groups, with a good neurological outcome in 2.2% of adrenaline patients versus 1.9 in the placebo group. Here you can see the neurological outcome in the two populations. And we can see that 87 patients out of the 4,000 epinephrine group achieved a favorable neurological outcome, and 74 instead in the placebo group. So a very small difference. And again, when we look to the neurological outcome in patient survivor, there was a higher percentage of patients with a severe disability or moderate severe disability in the adrenaline group compared to the placebo one. So the results of this trial were that there was a significant increase in long-term survival. So this was a positive trial, therefore. However, this increase was modest, 0.8%. And the study was overall underpowered because the predicted increase was 2%. The number needed to treat the patient are 113. However, there were no significant increase in survival with good neurological outcome, but actually a higher rate of poor neurological outcome was observed in a survivor treated with adrenaline. But we need to consider these two biases. The first is that adrenaline was given relatively later during CPR, after 21 minutes. And also, an important part of patients received the intraosseous administration of adrenaline compared to the intravenous one. This trial led ILCOR to perform a systematic review on the use of adrenaline, which show exactly the same results. So an effect, a clear effect on short-term outcome, also an effect on survival to hospital discharge, but no effect on neurological outcome. These are the last treatment recommendations published by ILCOR. So adrenaline is recommended during cardiopulmonary resuscitation. For non-shockable rhythm, it is recommended as soon as feasible. And for shockable rhythm, it is suggested after initial defibrillation attempts are unsuccessful. This is a very recent published post-hoc analysis of the paramedic 2, where the effect of IV versus IO administration of epinephrine was observed. And we can see that actually the benefit of administration of epinephrine was more evident for the IV administration, and instead was not present for the IO administration. However, this study was empowered to demonstrate a difference between the two routes of administration. Again, there is evidence that the earlier we administer epinephrine, the better it is. This is a study showing that for each minute of EMS of delay between EMS arrival and the epinephrine administration, there is a decrease of 4% in odds for survival. And similarly, this very recent trial showed that early administration of epinephrine, so within 10 minutes from cardiac arrest, is associated with a better survival and also a better neurological outcome compared to later administration, so after the 10 minutes. So in conclusion, there are concerns about epinephrine increasing unfavorable neurological outcome in survivors. However, any drug that increases the rate of ROSC and survival, but is administered late during CPR, can increase the number of patient survival with both favorable and unfavorable neurological outcome. Because probably when epinephrine was administered after 20 minutes, already important neurological damage were developed. So for this, the consensus is to continue to use adrenaline because it can increase ROSC and short-term outcome, but we need to focus efforts on providing earlier CPR, earlier administration of adrenaline, and then to improve the post-resuscitation care. Let's see now what is the evidence about the use of antiarrhythmic drug. First of all, we need to say that there are limited indications because the incidence of shockable arrhythmia is decreasing, and more than 90% of shockable arrhythmia are terminated after the third shock. These are two large clinical trials, not focusing on drugs, but showing that indeed VFVT occur in 20% approximately of patients without hospital cardiac arrest, and only 6% of patients receive an antiarrhythmic drug. And the same also for the in-hospital cardiac arrest, only 1/4 of patients receive an antiarrhythmic drug. Till a couple of years ago, the evidence for the use of amiodarone and lidocaine was based on these two trials. The first one is from Kudenchuk in 1999, where 500 patients were randomized to amiodarone or placebo, and the study showed an increased rate of patients surviving to hospital admission. Same results were shown in the other trial, enrolling 350 patients, more or less, from Dorian, 2002, where amiodarone showed improved survival to hospital admission compared to lidocaine. However, there were no trials focusing on long-term survival. In 2016, the Alps trial was published. This was a randomized trial where amiodarone, in its formulation called Nexterone, was compared to lidocaine or placebo. And the drug were administered after the first shock. The primary endpoint was survival to hospital discharge. 3,000 patients were randomized to the three drug treatments, 1,000 for each. Again, you can see no difference in the clinical characteristics of the population. But again, an important point is this one, that the drug was administered at 19 minutes from the call. So again, very late. In the EMS witness cardiac arrest, the drug were administered with approximately 8 minutes in advance, so 11 minutes. And when we look to the results, these are the results. So, cannot see very well. So basically, lidocaine increased the ROSC compared to placebo, and survival to hospital admission was increased in lidocaine and amiodarone. However, there were no difference for survival to hospital discharge or neurological outcome. Again, the study was unpowered because the predicted difference was 6.3% in the survival to hospital discharge, but the actual one was only 3.4%. And the 9,000 patients would have been enrolled to achieve the difference. This is the last treatment recommendation. Amiodarone and lidocaine are suggested for shock refractory VF and VT. And the use of prophylactic antiarrhythmic drugs after ROSC, instead there is no evidence to either support or refuse. Another important point is that lidocaine and amiodarone appeared as similar in the effect. There are, again, also here many bias. First of all, cordarone is the commonly used formulation of amiodarone, and cordarone includes polysorbate 80 as a diluent, which is known to produce hypotension. Instead, Nexterone, which is the one used in the trial, uses as a diluent Captisol, which has no hemodynamic effects. Survival rate were also greater in a patient with the witness cardiac arrest, especially if witnessed by EMS. And again, the drug were administered late, and a part of patient received an intraosseous administration. here you can see indeed that in the subgroup of patients with EMS witness cardiac arrest or bystander witness, amiodarone was superior to placebo in survival to hospital discharge. While this is the subgroup analysis for IV versus IO administration. And again, when amiodarone was administered the IV, there was a clear benefit for survival to hospital admission, but also for survival to hospital discharge and neurological outcome, but not when it was administered by IO. Again, anyway, this study was not powered to show difference between the two routes of administration. Finally, there are many knowledge gaps in the drug trials that I showed. We don't know the role for in-hospital cardiac arrest. We don't know the optimal bundle of care. We don't know if the etiology of cardiac arrest might have effect on the drug role. We don't know what is the optimal timing. We don't know also the effect of the diluent. We don't know the effect of the routes of administration, IV versus IO. We don't know the effect of bystander CPR and the quality of CPR. So many gaps. Nevertheless, what we know is that the adrenaline improves short and long-term survival with minimal trends toward better neurological recovery. Amiodarone and lidocaine improves ROSC, but no effect on long-term survival and neurological outcome. And with these are the current evidence for the use of these drugs. And I remind all of you that has been just published the 2020 a consensus on science with treatment recommendation, where all the evidence about amiodarone and epinephrine are summarized. So I invite all of you to read this just released in publication for have a clear view of all the evidence available for these drugs doing CPR. And with this, I thank you very much for the attention.